What if I told you could create AI agents to review your presentation before you present it? Let's find out in this next episode. I am delighted because we have Nancy Duarte, the eminent presentation guru who created the idea that presentations can have business impact. And because of her leadership, her authorship, there are so many awesome books. Welcome, Nancy, to the Coase AI Kitchen.
It's great to be here, John. Thanks for having me.
Well, we're going to cook something a little different today because I'm sure you've heard of the AI agent GPT revolution.
Yep.
Is this in your world, Nancy?
Yes, it is. I want to make some. We are trying to look into ways to use GPT's agents to review presentations right now. So this is going to be fun.
Okay. Well, you know, just because, Nancy, you've traveled the past of history, narrative, and you're super high tech as well. For that reason, we have invented a new technology to be able to make agents happen. It's called a microwave oven, basically. We have a toaster in the Coase AI Kitchen, but now we have a space-age microwave oven where we can now work with agents, as you can see here, right? We have different agents for writing copy, different agents to respond to things, and so this is our new way of working. However, we want to remember that these kind of things, these fancy personas, are created out of very simple things. They're created out of foundation models. We love foundation models in the kitchen. They're heavy. They're big, you know? And then we love to have, we have long grain embeddings, the ability to hold memories, to hold context, very important. And lastly, we have to remember that we have to have responsible AI. You know, responsible AI is the compass. And let's not forget, we need to measure the kind of goodness of the different AI things happening. Got to always do some LLM ops, it's called, right? And that's in the kitchen. We just cover everything. But let's get into the actual problem here. The problem is that we have this kind of probabilistic code, prompts. Have you been prompting a lot, Nancy?
I can slay. I can slay when I prompt.
I mean, don't forget, Nancy can like write, design. I can't imagine your prompting.
It's long and hysterical and yields incredible results. So,
and that's why we want to cook a meal with you, Nancy. Here we go. You ready?
Okay.
Eddie. Okay. All right. So what we're gonna do is, so I don't want to embarrass you, Nancy, but I'm selling all the books that you have because they're so good. Everyone go and get these books. So, and each of these books is different. But what I've been doing is looking at a lot of your interviews together with GPT. And I like how your point that if you don't adopt the idea, your idea is going to die. So being able to convey ideas is the magic of Nancy's world. And in 2012, she had an article in Harvard Business Review about how to write a presentation. And so what I've done, Nancy, is I've made a bad presentation. This is the embarrassing company update presentation, a generic and vague title with no clear agenda, financial overview, dense array of complex charts and graphs, no narrative or explanation provided. So as you see here, I've generated a bad non-Nancy Duarte presentation. I know it's hard for you to look at, I'm sure.
And one you would never build yourself.
I would try not to, but sometimes, you know, it's a tiring life sometimes, right? So, all right. Yeah. So now this is a better one. This is a Duartified, may I say, but not true Duartified. It's sort of a fake Duartified presentation. It has a different kind of intro. It has that notion of what is and what could be that you have really made clear to everyone in the world. And there's this notion of change. Now, Nancy, can you talk a bit about this methodology that you've created?
Yeah, it's after analyzing all of the 100 greatest speeches of all times, went to the Stanford Library and analyzed like all of the GE speeches all the way back to pre before the war. And I found that all of the great speeches create a cadence. There's a rise and a fall or a rhythm to them. And after analyzing them and doing a 3-year trip through storytelling, I found that that cathartic rise and fall comes from the gap contrast between what is and what could be. And you use that as a structural device to create a presentation that could influence someone. And then it ends with what's called the new bliss, where you restate how the world will be a better place when your idea is adopted. So it's very cool. I want to see what you're cooking up, John.
Well, Nancy's advised so many major TED speakers behind the scenes, right? Made their talks less Duarte, more Duarte. And but as we know, Nancy, the audience matters. That's the point you're trying to make, right? So let's spin up a virtual audience, shall we? Let's kind of fire up a kernel. Let's use the new GPT-4 preview model. Very good. Less expensive, but still more powerful. And then what we're going to do is I'm going to spin up two agents. One is a concerned employee. You are an employee who is concerned about the direction of the company. And as a result, you're an extreme skeptic when it comes to messages coming from leadership. And I also have a successful mid-level manager. You are a mid-level manager on the sales team who has had the best year of their career. You're optimistic and believe that leadership is doing a great job. Two perspectives, right? What I'm going to do is we're going to put them in the microwave oven and spin them up with the new agent kernel extension, semantic kernel. Now I have two agents available, the concerned employee and the successful mid-level manager. And now we're going to actually hatch the agents.
Okay.
Ready to go. I'm not sure if hatch is the right word or scientific.
I'm good with that.
they're hatched, ready to go. Now we're going to show the first presentation, the yawning bad presentation, to the agents. Here we go. Let's show it to them. All right. And now we're going to have agent number one, the unhappy agent, weigh in, the concerned employee. Now, Nancy, can you share what you've learned by presenting these kinds of assets to audiences? What are the pro tips for how to get customer research, audience research?
Yeah, I actually have been starting to use ChatGPT to do that. And so I think the biggest thing about an audience, when especially in business, when you're trying to move them, is to understand what roles have what KPIs or OKRs, because then anything you can attach to how they're being measured winds up being a really effective way to appeal to them. And the other thing is there's just some classic roles that are more heavily weighted analytical appeal, and others are more heavily weighted emotional appeal. And if you swing too far on either one based on the audience, it could turn into a disaster. So I think there's a whole lot of ways to figure out who the audience is. I look them up. I'll research before I get on a call. I look at their streams. I look at, you know, what they look at, who they follow on LinkedIn. All those things are ways to know a heck of a lot about a human that you might be needing to approach or talk to.
So it's kind of like you tweak the persona in different extremes to kind of find the reaction.
Yep.
That's so cool. So now I'm going to ask the successful mid-level manager. If you noticed, the unhappy employee was very unhappy with the presentation. The successful mid-level manager is finding like, well, it's not that great, but it's okay. It's going to be all right kind of thing. So what occurs is that, again, as we know, depending upon the audience, the message lands differently. What do we know from history about that, Nancy? I'm really curious.
Yeah, everybody comes to a moment or a presentation or a piece of communication with their own bias or filters that they've kind of played through time. And so what happens is the burden is on the communicator to empathetically understand what it is they need to say or do or communicate to that role, to that individual. And what's interesting is sometimes we speak to a broad audience, but other times we're speaking to a single person. And the amount of work you do either way, the burden of persuasion or influence is definitely on the role of the speaker and them understanding the audience to its fullest, as much as you can understand. Your heart should warm when you see them. Your everything that you filter should be about how they will be transformed and how they'll be a better human for having sat through your talk. And clearly the employee who's not super excited didn't even have very interesting feedback. on the presentation. So they're really disengaged, I'd say.
Oh my gosh, YouTube audience, are you feeling the wisdom of this moment? Are you becoming a better presenter? Maybe our agents are listening in. Now, what you can also do, Nancy, as we know, is we can actually have the agents debate with each other. So I'm now going to ask these two employees to debate turn take how they believe the presentation was, and have the other one debate the other. So you can actually sort of like use them to talk to each other. Have you been trying this yourself, Nancy?
Yeah, we actually ask anytime you're in a situation where there might be competing perspectives, we actually have our customers set up a fake debate, or we have them pelt with like almost unrealistic kinds of questions or opinions or perspectives. So getting to a place where there's aligned perspective takes work, and the presenter has to work through that in their mind. And it's hard to do that without the help of other people giving their perspective, or we even sometimes, if it's a high stakes piece of communication, we'll have people kind of attack the actual presenter in a way, like aggressively, so they're prepared just in case something flares up they're not expecting.
Well, and then after we've done this, we have to, of course, clean up the agents. So, okay, we're cleaning them up and back to the kitchen. And so when you think about this, Nancy, this is something you already use in your practice of designing, crafting presentations with an audience. Are there tips you want to give to the visiting kitchen audience on how to do this best?
Yeah, I've experimented with all the tools, and you have to give it a lot of instructions to be able to really know how to craft the title, craft the speaker notes, craft the what goes on the slide, what doesn't go on slides. I do believe in some ways that creativity and critical thinking could obsolesce if we over torque and just use whatever is given to us from these tools. I have not yet found something that had to be heavily, you know, humanized by a human, whether it's coming up with a really unique concept. Pretty much a lot is kind of cliche and very common. So to come up with something that makes it so unique, so you stand out in your industry, is going to take, prompts of a lifetime. it's amazing. And it's a great brainstorming tool. I use it every day. I don't feed my material in it every day, but I use it every day. I have a fully licensed enterprise version of all this stuff.
Well, on behalf of all people who try to get an idea across, Nancy, I want to thank you for bringing your methodology to everyone, and also for showing us how to use AI to make a better presentation.
Thanks for having me. I just adore you. And this, I've learned so much from this show, so it's an honor to be on it.
Well, hearts back at you. Well, all right. Thank you. And let's keep these episodes going.